The following is a presentation of WHYY, Philadelphia, Wilmington.
Tonight on Real Philadelphia, a potpourri of independent film, outstanding and outrageous.
Good evening. I'm Amos Vogel. Welcome to the last in our five program series entirely devoted to independently produced films in the Delaware Valley. As founder and former director of the New York Film Festival at Lincoln Center, and now as professor at the Annenberg School of Communications at the University of Pennsylvania, I've spent my entire life writing and thinking about film and discovering new film talents. And that's what I'm continuing to do right here with this program. Our films tonight, again, are a cross-section of independent cinema revealing its range and originality. Our first film is a 7-minute animation by Scott Bracken of Yardley, Pennsylvania, that combines traditional Walt Disney-type cartooning with modern art. It was drawn by hand and then photographed one film frame at a time. When these thousands of drawings are then projected at regular speed, movement, or rather the illusion of movement, is created and the drawings become an animated film. I like this work because it's strange, it's a bit mysterious, and gives you an eerie, well-achieved feeling of being in some other universe. You might even call this film Close Encounters of a Surrealist Kind. It has a haunting atmosphere created by the drawings and strongly reinforced by the music of the Allman Brothers. It has won 3 international awards. Here it is.
Thank you.
We have all seen films about art or about artists. Well, here's one that is different because it's being told to us differently. Usually art films are like filmed reports. They show artists at work or artists talking to us. This one is more like a poem. As in poetry, nothing is explicit. Everything is evocative and resonant, and we must work and open ourselves to absorb what is being offered. Just like in a poem, sometimes we don't quite know what we are being told or where we are, but ultimately, we are being reached on a deeper level. Our unconscious comes into play much more directly than if we were watching a documentary. Here, the artist is a Philadelphia potter. The filmmaker is Peter Rose, who quite beautifully describes this mysterious philosophical work as a meditation on, quote, the powers of fire, the nature of the creative act, the vessels, rooms, and chambers in which certain transformations take place. The opaque, magical quality of art, asserted in dialogue and visuals, is embedded in the very form and structure of the film itself. It is this fusion of form and content which brings about the success of this 8-minute work.
In the furnace, the heat in the heart, the crucible, the womb. With what intentions are these chambers sealed? By which totemic spirits are they watched? For how long do they smoke, smolder, and cure? When are they ripe? It is a sublimation attended by fear and by a great ritual caution. It's a way of dreaming slowly through heat. There is a way of being lost, of wandering in a chaos of your own design and dreaming order. It's a way of waiting, of hunting the invisible by suspending thought and being watchful. The image is encountered in perplexity at first, speaks in riddles, offers no name, resists approach. You play with it. It hides. You stop and yield to reverie and find it then among the ruins. It's a kind of quiet battle from which you return with an enigma, fashioned from the shards and broken shells of other dreams.
The last two films on tonight's program reflect widely and wildly divergent lifestyles. They're each about 25 minutes long, and I'll therefore postpone my introduction to the second film until after you've seen the first. Lawrence Saltzman, a young American, used his Fulbright scholarship to spend 2 years in Romania photographing the remnants of a vanishing civilization, East European Jewry. Amidst poverty, degradation, and persecution, they used to live their meager lives until sent to extermination camps by the Nazis. A few returned and attempt to live as if nothing had happened. Saltzman's film is important because he resolutely resists what could have been easy sentimentality and because he attempts to abolish the barrier between the spectator and the usually invisible, godlike filmmaker by explicitly, repeatedly revealing his own presence behind the camera. Despite this deeply personal note, the narration and its delivery are deliberately flat and descriptive, activating our reasoning powers for further impact and poignancy. An air of held-in sadness permeates this work.
Thank you. I had been awarded a Fulbright grant in photography to go to Romania and went there in the summer of 1974. I had chosen Romania because I was interested in spending some time in an Eastern European country with a strong folk culture, and although other countries might have qualified, I specifically chose Romania because, with my background in Romance languages, I thought it would be much easier to learn Romanian, a Latin-based language. Then there were the childhood memories and associations. One of my aunts was from Bucharest. I recollected her stories of King Carol and Romania in the 1930s. I had decided, at the suggestion of a friend at the Folklore Institute in Bucharest, to visit Radeuți. I was told it had an interesting weekly peasant market, and also that the adjoining area would be nice to visit. I had been misinformed as to which day the market was, and arrived a day too late to see it. Instead, I went to early morning services at the town's main synagogue. There were 9 men present. They were waiting for a 10th man to make up their minyan. Their services were conducted by Rabbi Joseph Tiernauer.
Rav Yosef Levi Tirner, man tat sich in Ruf in mehrere Städtlich in Rumänien. Sind es man tat sich ausgegangen, kann jetzt ins Ruhr, in zu schien, jetzt Chess, zu besetzt ins Fass. Tat sich als ob es mehrere, sie mussten jeder gekannt, der gewinne, a Rav Gudel beteuer gemacht zu Hurem. In dort auf dem Platz...
Rabbi Tirnauer came from a family of rabbis and had studied with the great rabbis of Pressburg in Czechoslovakia. During World War II, most of the rabbi's family were killed in concentration camps. He himself had suffered a great deal during those years. However, in spite of this, he remained very good-natured and always wore a warm smile. Besides being the town's rabbi, he also acted as the shohet and moel, officiating at brits and weddings, of which there was one of each during the time I was in Radeuți.
Das Leben in der Gules ist nicht schlecht, wie man sagt, begasch mir. Man hat alle Rechte, man hat alle Freiheiten. Man hat sich ein PZP mit Saftet, man hat sich mehr, man fuhrt, man geht. Ich muss ja gar nicht gut in Preis.
Eventually, I was to get to know quite well all of the men who were present at this first early morning service. There was Israel Baer, Mr. Klugsman, Joseph Tiernauer, Moses Lehrer, Mr. Ginzer, Herman Gelber, Mr. Stein and his father, and Mr. Samstag, the synagogue's gobber. Later, I was to see the market which had brought me to Radeuți. It was located on the town's main plaza, just cut a corner from the big temple where I had attended the early morning service. This was a market to which peasants from many of the surrounding small communities came to sell their handicrafts and agricultural products. These included hand-woven and embroidered shirts, belts, towels, and rugs. Fresh cheese, eggs, and spentina, the sour cream used on their mamaliga, could also be found. Chickens would be sold, which sometimes ended up on a Jewish family's Sabbath dinner table. Once a week, Joseph Tiernauer, acting as shohet, would ritually slaughter chickens that were brought to him by members of the Jewish community. He also performed the same service for nearby Jewish communities in the towns of Siret, Batra Dorna, Gora Humorului, and Kimpilung Moldovanesc. The fee for slaughtering a chicken was 3 Romanian lei, or about 36 cents.
Lach und träume süß von Liebe, deine Augen schließ von Liebe, lege deine Hände still in meine Hände, schlaf und träume süß. Sonny boy, schlaf und träume süß, Sonny boy, deine Augen schließ, Sonny boy, lege deine Hände still in meine Hände, schlaf und träume süß, Sonny boy.
Preparations for the beginning of the Sabbath began early in the day. At the Tau family's house, a Romanian barber came to shave Mr. Tau. His hair hardly needed cutting. Meanwhile, his wife busied herself preparing the dough for the challah bread that would be served with their Shabbos meal. Many of the Jewish wives of the town make their own challah for each Sabbath, and oftentimes I was the lucky recipient of one of these breads. During my stay in Radeutz, I gradually came to be adopted, so to speak, by many of the town's Jewish families. I was the same age as their children, many of whom had departed for Israel. I had many Jewish mothers who, like Jewish mothers everywhere, always held forth something good to eat. Even in the most humble homes, people were generous and very kind. It was always, Lorenz, was tut sie? Was machen Sie? Wie gehen Sie? I gradually also came to see the people of Radeutz as my own family. Mr. Tau, in his early days, had been a farmer. He came to Radeutz just after the Second World War. His farm had been in the northern section of the Bukovina, and he, like many others, fled south when the Russians occupied the area. Now retired and living on a small pension, Yonko Tau lives with his wife in a small two-room apartment very near to the Jewish baths. These baths were built by the Jewish community and still today are maintained and run by the Jewish community. There is still a ritual mikveh, and the steam rooms and showers of the bath are used by both the Jewish and non-Jewish population of Radeutz. Fridays, people busy themselves getting clean for the Sabbath, including the Rabbi Tiernauer. At sundown, In all the Jewish homes of the town, the Sabbath candles are lit, and wives wait for their husbands to return from Sheol. The specially baked challah and other Sabbath dishes await their correct blessings. I lived for almost 2 years in Radeutz, and from my hotel window, I could see the comings and goings of the town's folk. Radeutz had once been a veritable Jewish town, a Yiddish shtetl, if you will, where Yiddish was heard in almost all the stores and where the famous Jewish lieder singer, Josef Schmidt, had lived and had been for a time the cantor in the synagogue. In talking about their town, people used to say that Es war schon einmal. That was before World War II. Then, the Jews, on orders from the Germans, were rounded up and deported. They were not sent direct to concentration camps, but instead to an area in the Ukraine between the Bug and Dnister rivers known as Transnistria. There they were ghettoized in towns in places like Mogilev, Jurin, and Kapogorod. And without the benefit of warm clothing and adequate food and forced to do hard labor, many died. Of the 8,000 Jews deported from Radeutz, only 2,000 survived the war. And many of those who came back came with permanent scars. They came back to find their houses destroyed, and many, with help from Jewish agencies, continued on towards the Jewish homeland. Some, though, were tied to the town by tradition and time, and they stayed on. Mr. Moses Lehrer remained after the war and brought up a family. As a Kohen and a Vishnitzer Hussid, he looked after the Vishnitzer Shiel. The Shiel, located on a side street, offers only a faint glimmer of its former beauty and importance. There, Moses told me that it was so full you could not even get a seat. During most of the time I was in Radeutz, I attended services at this Shiel, and its members jokingly called me a Vishnitzer Hussid. Community existed among the men who came to pray at this shul. Most of them were long-term friends, and most were the Arbeitsleute. Moses Lehrer also looked after the physical needs of the shul. When a window pane was broken, he fixed it. When a door needed to be rehinged, he rehinged it. He and his wife planted a garden in the adjoining yard. The corn stalks from this garden went to make up the sukkah at sukkah time. Once, there were 23 small prayer houses in Radeutz, all buzzing with activity. The Wiesnitzer Schiele is one of the three still open, and probably soon its doors will close, because already several of its needed members have departed for Israel or have died. The Wiesnitzer Schiele will then become the house of a Romanian family who will never know anything at all about the great Wiesnitzer Rebbe and the men who used to come to pray at his synagogue. Jews provided many services and skills to the overall community. In addition to the usual doctors, lawyers, and teachers, many practiced small crafts. The area was rich in furs, and almost all of the town's furriers were Jewish. Israel Bear bought and sold furs, and also kept a flock of his own sheep on a meadow nearby to Radutz. One day I went to visit them with him, and we were served some freshly made cheese. Frau Marcus Faber, as a young girl, had fled during World War I to Vienna to escape the Russians, who were then occupying the Bukovina. There she learned how to be a hat maker and still continues to make hats in the style that she learned then. Her customers are mostly peasants, and oftentimes they pay for work done in part with some fresh produce. There was no real undertaker in town. When a person died, the Jewish community was immediately notified, and they made arrangements to send out the community-owned horse-drawn hearse. At the funeral of Mr. Cohen, there was some dispute as to just how much to pay the ritual washer. He wanted 150 lei, or about $16. He said, "You have it cheaper. If there were two of us here, it would cost you twice as much." The washing of the body in preparation for burial used to be considered an honor, and was done by the more well-to-do. Today, the task is carried out by Mr. Levy, who needs the fees it brings. The body is dressed in a white bag-like suit called a tachrichim. During my stay in Raduz, I had the occasion to go to about 15 Jewish funerals. In the beginning, I did not know the person whose funeral I was attending, but before long, I was attending the funerals of people whom I had photographed.
Thank you.
If the film you've just seen is the record of a lifestyle and social reality that has largely disappeared, one wonders if the next film represents a lifestyle to come. The contrast could not be more severe. Frederick Andrew Shore, Maggie Carson, and Julius Kosakowski shot it at New York's famous punk rock CBGB club. The elderly Jews of Saltzman's film reflect an ancient faith and ancient tradition. The lack of faith and tradition in our next film is startling and deliberate. The punk rock movement, in my opinion, constitutes a rebellion on the part of some of our young, just like the Beats and the hippies did, against establishment, parents, state. As is true of any rebellion, it may be misguided or more than justified. Punk rock is an attempt to reintroduce color, excitement, theatricality into a mechanized world viewed as drab, alienated, and corrupt. In a very real sense, I consider this 24-minute punk rock film to be as ethnographic as Saltzman's film on the Romanian Jews. It is unquestionably a more honest portrayal of certain realities of contemporary life than can be found in a dozen soap operas, horror films, or televised game shows. In any case, do not confuse portrayal with endorsement. This film portrays a contemporary reality. It does not ask you to condone or support it. However put off some of you may be by this film, try to view it, as you should view all the films in this series, with an open mind. Before we see it, I've been asked to announce that in the opinion of this station, this film may be unsuitable for children and offensive to some adults. I make this announcement under protest and with some merriment. First, I do not believe that many children would be watching films about Romanian Jews at 10:30 at night. Secondly, and more seriously, I'm convinced that the daily television bombardment of violence and murder, brutality and betrayals, game shows and commercials, is far more dangerous to kids than the film you're about to see. In any case, I hope you can see that to prevent all of you from seeing this film, because it may be offensive to some of you, would be the worst possible solution. I'll have more to say after you have seen the film.
Great weekend. There's a thrilling, this next number is called I Belong to the Blank Generation.
Blank. No, I'm blank, you know. There's nothing coming in, there's nothing going out, but I belong. So I'm here, that's actually why I'm here, not every Saturday.
This is the blank generation. Look around you, ladies and gentlemen. Here we are. Excuse me. Are you a member of the blank generation?
No. Well, I have no comment. I don't want to incriminate myself here.
There's the blank generation. See? Like, no commitment, no involvement. That's where it's at.
What is CBGB's to you? It's a local club. I live a few blocks away. I come free because I'm privileged, you know? So I come to see my favorite band. It's a good band, you know. It's an open forum, you know?
You think CBGB's is important to underground music?
You know, if you want to talk about, like, punk and underground is bullshit. Everybody is their own person and their own thing. The Dead Boys are the Dead Boys. The Dictators are the Dictators. The Ramones are the Ramones, and they're all fucking great. You call them punk because you got nothing else to say about them. No other way to link them, but it's like the heartbeat that links them, you know? The beat. Rock and roll is the music that makes you, you know, feel alive.
Love comes first, they misled us all this time. We believed that love was constant, you know? Mommy, love, love, mommy. But love comes first. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I was just Charlie, wanted all of the wild moves. I just saw most of them. They were the most of them. They were the most of them. Like some of the nose. A 14 and a half, and it wasn't.
Yes, and the keyboards and all that bullshit. Everybody's so concerned about being a fucking musician. And, like, you know, you get bands, you know, in rock and roll, anybody can play. Whether you know or not, I mean, like Iggy Studios, those guys, they couldn't fucking play their instruments. You know, Sex Pistols can't play their instruments now, really. You know, lead
really
guitarists can't play leads, yeah.
When you get right down
good.
To it.
And
Sex Pistols
like, yeah,
are great.
It's like, you know, they got, you know, it's there, man. They got talent.
The band of Buck,
but
the band of Beck,
Columbia
Beck,
Records
Cochran
don't think
they
have no
they
talent, you know?
How much did you guys rehearse for this show?
Nothing at all.
We haven't played in a month.
We haven't
played
together for a month. No shit.
Sissy's rehearsed. Yeah. I am the Nazi-Kaiser. I am the Nazi-Kaiser. Do what I want, but I know how to get it. I'm one of the stars.
See the Dead Boys. I'm here to see how great rock and roll is supposed to be done by the Dead Boys. The Dead Boys have shown me tonight how rock and roll should be done.
How should it be done?
With ain't no pyrotechnics, No phony showmanship, just pure rock and roll energy, pure guts, pure stamina.
There's no bass either.
No bass, that's fine. That's fine, they don't need it. I don't see anyone complaining. Do you?
Why am I here? Because the Dead Boys are the best fucking rock and roll band on the East Coast.
Why?
Why? I don't know, they're psychotic. They're great, I love them. What else do you want to know?
You like their music or them?
Oh, I like them and their music. Except for Bader's because he's a pervert.
What do you like about their music?
Frantic, it's high energy. I like it.
How does that affect you?
How does it affect me? I don't know, it made me want to kill my mother once, but I didn't do it. Really, I didn't do it. I wouldn't do that.
But why did it make you want to kill your mother?
You
don't know?
It just did, you know.
Was that a good feeling?
Yeah, you know.
What?
Yeah, it was intense.
Why are you here tonight?
To see the Dead Boys.
Why?
Because they're great fucks.
How do you know?
Because I fucked them. Who do you want in the rundown, Ann?
Did you throw the,
Yeah, I did. That was my present. I'm Lunch. They do a song called I Need Lunch. I'm Lydia Lunch.
Why did you, throw that? What was it?
They were used tampons. Genuinely used. New ones. Why did I give them to them? Because they're going to eat them the second set.
You sure of that?
You'll see. Yeah, because they're their favorite toys.
What did that girl throw up on stage at you?
Oh, I'll show you. Why did she throw up, or what did she throw up? It's,
Pubes?
Everybody needs a little bit of,
Old rags. Yowza, old rags.
Why do you think she did that?
She knew
she's
we liked
an admirer.
Tea.
Her favorite dish, man.
She's an admirer. Our fans do stuff like that.
We can't afford tomato soup.
Because they think that we're sick, you know? And I don't have the slightest idea in the world why they think we're sick.
We're normal.
You're not sick?
Nah.
They're sick. My mother thinks I am, but Ma, I.
Do you guys want to be?
As successful as I can get. Because, hi, Ma. It's me again.
I want my picture on all the papers. I want to get laid.
I want to be richer than you. I want to be richer than you and Dad. You know that, Mom? Because then the house in Florida that you asked me for when I made it, I ain't going to give you. You know that, Mom?
Atmosphere when it's crowded here and loud is conducive to violence?
No, I think the more crowded and the louder it is, I think the less violence. I think, first of all, there's no room for violence. I think when it's so loud, nobody can say anything nasty to anybody. They can't hear. And, There's no violence. I think any little violence, anything that starts up maybe like, well, when people can communicate. it's a shame. I think that's the one thing I really dislike in this scene is that there's a lack of communication between people. Maybe the vibrations